Welcome.
Сайн байцгаана уу хүнд үзэгчтэй. Өнөөдөр ороо DeFacto нэвтрүүлгийн зочноор Дээрхийн гигантийн 14 дүгээр Dalai Lama данзан жамц оролцож байна.
Дээрхийн гигийн 14 дүгээр Dalai Lama данзан жамц 1935 оны 7 сарын 6-нд мэндэлжээ. Төвдийн зүүнхад хэсгийн таксарт мужийн амдоо гэдэг жижиг тосгонд нэгэн тариачны гэр бүлд мэндэлсэн Лама Дондуф нэртэй 2 настай хүүг 13 дугаар Dalai Lama төвдөн гяцгийн хой дүрээр тодруулан өргөмжилжээ. Харин Dalai Lama гэдэг монгол нэрийг 1578 онд Төмөдийн Алтан хаан анх өгч. Дээрхийн гигантийн Dalai Lama нь төвд болоод монголчуудын дунд амьд бурхан химээ 400 гаруй жилийн туршид дээдлэгдэн иржээ. 13 дугаар Dalai Lama данзан жамц нь бүхий л амьдралаа бусдыг гэгэрүүлэх, сургах, сайн үлийг түгээн дэлгэрүүлэх үйлс хийж, өөрийн хувийн жаргалаа умартан бусдын сайн сайхны төлөө явж байгаа хүн юм. Хамгийн чухал нь түүний хийж хэлж буй зүйлс нь дандаа инх тайван, эв найрамдлыг тунхагласан байдаг. Дээрхийн гигантийн төвдийн эрх чөлөөний төлөө хүч хэрэглэхгүй тэмцлийнхээ төлөө 1989 онд Нобелийн инх тайвны шагнал авчээ. Ямар ч их төрөмгийлэл байсан хүч үйл хэрэглэх бодлогыг л тууштай баримталдаг хүн. Дээрхийн гигийн 6 төвийн 62 гаруй улсаар аялж, олон ерөнхийлөгч, ерөнхий сайд, хаан хаттай уулзжээ. Мөн тэрээр төрөл бүрийн шашны тэргүүд, алдартай эрдэмтэдтэй уулзаж, яриа өрнүүлж байсан юм. 1959 оноос хойш түүнийг инх тайвныг бусдад түгээж байгаад нь шашин хоорондын ойлголцол бий болгож, хүч хэрэгэлдгүй үзэл баримтлал мөн дэлхийн нийтийн өмнө өөрөг хариуцлага хүлээж, энергийн нинжин сэтгэл гаргасныхын төлөө 80-аад шагнал өргөмжлөл гардуулсан байна. Дээрхийн гигийн 14-р Dalai Lama 72 ном тойрволжээ. Тэр өөрийгөө энгийн нэгэн буддын лам гэдэг. Dalai Lama-ийн зөвхөн DeFacto нэвтрүүлэгт өгсөн ярилцлагын 1-р хэсгийг хүлээн авнау.
Good evening, Your Holiness. Are you keep still remantling and demantling your watches?
Occasionally, sometimes.
You know, Mongolia, for the last 25 years, keep going through big transition, economic, political, and spiritual. And after 25 years, we still look for certain ideological, spiritual backgrounds. And how do you see today, after 25 years of shifting from communism to capitalism, the modern Mongolia?
I think, like China, during Cultural Revolution, and you see in this sort of period, deliberately destroy their traditional culture and also spirituality like Buddhism. But then, see, any spirituality is very much related with our emotions and culture also. I think very much part of their life. So political reason try to eliminate, very difficult. Now look China, the Buddhist faith and other faith also now growing very rapidly. Similarly Mongolia and also some part of Russia, a traditionally Buddhist country, once, you see, deliberately minimize or reduce or destroy like Mongolia, Chepalsang during that period. A lot of damage, a lot of monk killed, including many scholars.
Temples were destroyed.
But when I, so my first visit to Mongolia, 1979, still communist. Mm-hmm. So many officials, outwardly communist, atheist. But when we met alone, they show religious faith. So therefore, naturally, although you see the now more capitalist sort of lifestyle, and also the material development, and with modern education, sometimes you see people in certain time, you see people more attract about material value. And then the time passes, the material value will not bring inner peace.
That's what is happening in Mongolia today.
Now China also. Okay. Many rich people, as far as money is concerned, material things is concerned, plenty.
Yes.
But these people, some of them, many of them, I think, you see really, in deep insight, you see now they some kind of what's it, they deeper interest or also try to seek some deeper meaning. Mm-hmm. In the West also. So therefore, now I think the important is as far as the Mongolia is concerned, your nation, I think around, I think, several centuries, Buddhism is the main religious tradition. So Mongolia, actually, Buddhist country. So Mongolian way of life, culture, very much related with Buddhism. So therefore, Buddhism is one of the important aspects of Mongolian identity.
It is.
Like Tibet, Tibetan.
Yes.
Buddhism is our sort of national sort of identity. But among Tibetan, there are some Christians, some Muslims there.
Yes.
But as a nation, Buddhism is something important. So similarly, Mongolia also that. Therefore, now you need some sort of effort for preservation of your traditional value, not just through faith, but educate. As far as Buddhism is concerned, of course, I respect all major religious traditions, Christianity, Judaism, Islam, all these, I respect. At the same time, Buddhism, particularly the Nalanda tradition, is the whole tradition based on reasons. So therefore, number of scientists, many of them non-believer.
Yes.
But as far as Buddhism is concerned, see the every sort of us, they are practice based on reason. So they also showing interest.
Yes.
So therefore, I think education, knowledge.
Yes.
About you see Buddhist philosophy, and particularly Buddhist psychology. So that as a part of secular education, this, see, not as a religion,
yes,
but as a sort of academic subject,
yes,
you can introduce.
Yes.
That's, I think, proper way for preservation of Buddha Dharma with modern development.
Yes, Mongolia, today we call it democratic capitalism.
Mm-hmm.
Which creates more material value, hopefully, arguably. Do you agree with the democratic capitalism is being the best out of all forms that humankind tried?
I think so. A democracy is, I think, future of humanity, the political sort of system. I think that's the anyway. Because I always said, telling people, and also I believe, the world belongs to 7 billion human beings. And each nation, you see, belongs to the people of the nation, of the country.
Yes.
Not religious leader, not one political party, or kings or queens. Sometimes it's come, sometimes it go. So people always remain there. So therefore, my own case, since 2011, I totally sort of retired from political responsibility. Not only myself retired, but 4-century-old tradition, Dalai Lama institution, automatically become head of both temporal and spirituality. Now that ended. Because I believe democracy is the best through election. Free election is to choose their leader. And the leader should be accountable to the people. If leadership goes something wrong, the people have the sort of power to dismiss like that. So democratic system is the best system, okay, in spite of some drawback. Mm. And then capitalism. I think capitalism gives people the freedom of utilize individual creativity. Centralized autonomy, centralized to the economy system. Yes. You see, it's much harmful to utilize individual creativity. At the same time, capitalism, like some of the capitalist country, you see, complete freedom, at the same time, proper divisions about power, legislate, and then administrations, and then independent judiciary system. So some sort of regulations.
That's not a very clear case in Mongolia. They are confusing.
So you have to work.
Yes, we have to work.
Welcome.
Your Holiness, I visit India. I visited Dharamsala. I saw people happy. Nobody's arguing. Though India is one of the extreme poor and rich country, but everybody is smiling. And yet, if we ask questions, are we smiling in Mongolia? No, not that much. What makes a nation happy?
And that's why, you see, the combination material value, material development, and inner development must go together. We should not treat it as a mission. We are human beings. We have the feeling,
yes,
pains and pleasure and
yes,
these things. So therefore, this very much related with our inner way of thinking. So inner value is the real source to bring inner peace. Money, power, will not.
Yes.
Sometimes I think people become richer, richer, more powerful,
yes,
more anxiety,
yes,
more stress.
Yes. How can a society...
And then I think Mongolian may be traditionally warrior.
Yeah,
so better to less smile.
How can a society also, you said about material and spiritual life, also important. But now, at this time today, we are divided by political interests, by our provinces. We are all time sort of argue in Mongolia. How can we get together in peace and harmony?
Now we need wider perspective look. Sometimes when I met some Taiwanese friend, I telling them the different party. Sometimes you see too much concern their own party, forgetting or less interest about national interest.
Yes.
So similarly, it is possible, you see, different people, different group of people only interest their own sort of acidic concern. So all part of Mongolian, all common responsibility is build healthy Mongolia.
Exactly.
Prosperity, at the same time, rich spirituality. That's the, everybody's interest, all Mongolians' interest. And not only the independent Mongolia, but also, you see, your brothers in China and also in Russia. So you are the independent Mongolian sort of as a country. So you see, you should lead combination of material value, material development, and a several century old your rich tradition. Combine these two things. Material development, modern technology, modern education provide us physical comfort. And traditional value brings inner comfort.
Yes. What spirituality and religion, and according to your teachings, not necessarily must be together, can be secular ethics, and why that spiritual life is so important, must be for happiness. Why?
That's now, according a medical scientist, the peace of mind is very important for good health, physical health.
Very simple.
Constant anger, hatred, fear, very bad for our health. So inner peace of mind is very, very important. Now, peace of mind, you can't buy on supermarket.
Yes.
I think maybe some Mongolian supermarket can selling.
But
I think peace of mind.
Some people think in Mongolia they can buy it. You know how? They do something wrong, bad. But they go to temple and ask them, please pray and forgive me. And they pay money and pray. How does it work? It doesn't work, isn't it?
That's right. Particularly we Buddhists, you see, we have no concept of creator. So Buddha, as teacher, his responsibility is teach us, showing us how to build peace of mind. Since he not as a creator, so our future will not give by Buddha. Our future must create by ourselves.
Yes.
And right motivation, with right vision, and right behavior. Only Buddha said, Buddha says, you are your own master. So your future depends on you, yourself.
How important compassion is? I'm asking the question because in Mongolia, they regard unfortunate poor people not in good way. They even think you don't give them much nothing because they had a bad life in their previous life, so they are not sort of bad people. That's what they say, and very bad attitude to poor people, beggars. How can we change it?
That's I think the wrong view. In India also, the caste system, they usually sometimes you see people from sort of well-being sort of community. Yes. They telling the poor people, low caste, they say, oh, do your own karma. And nothing can be. That's your own destination. So that's, from the Buddhist viewpoint, totally wrong. So, Buddha state, we all have Buddha nature.
How important is to give?
So, now here, the poorer section of people, she should develop self-confidence. We are equal. So those more successful life, better family, The poorest section of people, also same human being, they should work hard and be equal. And then the society of the people should help in this in the form of education, health, and some training. So that's the way to reduce this gap, rich and poor. So it is totally wrong. Look, the poorest section of people, or your own sort of karma, that's your destination. It's totally wrong.
In Mongolia,
Buddha takes special care, beggars, poor people,
yes,
and sick people. One occasion, Buddha saw one person sick, nobody taking care. The Buddha himself, you see, washing his feet, his foot, and then Ananda, you see, let Ananda bring some water, like that. So that's our teacher sort of, so they show us, you see, that's the example.
That's, I think, missing not that much. That's something what we need in Mongolia.
This is sometimes among Tibetan, also I think Mongolian, maybe some higher lama, they remain on throne.
Yes.
When they, you see, come across some poor people, yes, they may, or they are too high, may not take care of these things. That's totally wrong, totally wrong.
Okay, in Mongolia.
So these are, I think, there are, you see, any religion, the actual society sort of certain sort of what's the habit also influence. Some of our sort of monastic institution or lama institution, a little bit feudal sort of habit. Now we must change. We must realize that. We must change.
Your Holiness, it's a very important issue for many Mongolians about superstition and religion, because nowadays even many Mongolians think there are good days, bad days. They don't even cut their hair one day. They don't travel the other day. What are bad days for you, and are they correct?
As Buddha stated clearly, things, you see, happen due to your own previous karma. Karma means action.
Yes.
So that means everything depends on your own behavior, not due to certain stars or certain days like that.
I see.
Then fifth Dalai Lama, in his autobiography, you see, he mentioned very detailed the day his birth, the stars, all these he mentioned. And then at the end he mentioned, although at that same time, a lot of dogs also born.
So they are, all days are good.
Yes.
What is a difference between shamanism and Buddhism? You know, in some ways, some dance we had before in early 30s, before they destroyed our temples. Some dance, it looks like, and also the shamanism, shamans, looks like the same. What a difference.
Now that, as far as Tibet is concerned, before Buddhism reached Tibet, that means mainly 7th century and 8th century. So before that, the Pan tradition, similar shamanism. So I think whole Asia, this area, I think shamanism is native religion. So there are sort of main sort of also the sort of main thing is simply worship some different deities, the local deities, and then. So after Buddhism reached Tibet, at the beginning, some difficulties, even in some cases some clash. That's understandable. You see, when some new ideas,
like
new tradition,
in Mongolia too,
come from outside, come from India, then local sort of spirituality, local tradition, sort of a little bit sort of resistance. Then time passes, the Buddhism is a realistic approach. A lot of reasons. So then eventually, you see, Tibetan emperors, they fully accept Buddhist teaching or Buddhist tradition, Buddhism. And then eventually, among the Pambu tradition, traditional religion, Tibetan own sort of local religion, also then become much enriched through Buddhist concept, Buddhist philosophy. Now today, in Tibet, the Pan tradition, very similar that of Buddhist tradition.
I see.
And okay.
Дэлхийн 14-р Далай Лам данзан жамцын оролцсон DeFacto нэвтрүүлгийн үргэлжлэлийг 12-р сарын 31-ний 18 цаг 40 минутаас хүлээн авч үзээрэй.
You're on.